From out of the heart of the English Midlands comes the gear new sound that's rocking the airwaves. Move over, mop tops, look out, Liverpool. The Mersey Beat has moved upstream. And in 1965, all the mods are going to be rocking to the fabulous Birmingham Brumbeat.
It was around the time where the Mersey boom hit, and everybody assumed what they termed as Brumbeat. Brumbeat, an abbreviation or a slang for Birmingham. And Brumbeat was going to be the next big thing.
There's probably 10,000 groups in the, you know, the metropolitan area, the outer city of Birmingham.
These lads are full of fun, and they'll do anything to show their fans a good time. Make no mistake about it, the Brumbeat is one musical mania that's definitely here to stay.
It was absolutely fantastic. Everybody wanted to have a northern accent. Even the Sloan Rangers and the Upper Crust, all trying to say, you know, call blimey, and everybody wanted to be a working class hero.
Ray and John were in a band called El Riot and the Rebels. We used to call that El Root and the Rabble. And I was in a band called Jerry Levine and the Avengers, and they all used to call us Jerry Latrine and the Four Flushers.
I was Johnny C. Storm, my name was. In those days, you know, everything had to be really over the top.
We all sat there waiting to become like the Beatles and Jerry and the Pacemakers and the Dakotas and all that sort of stuff.
Brumbeat was going to be the next big thing. And of course, it didn't happen.
Once upon a time, in your wildest dream. In your wildest dream. In your wildest dream.
Freezing out there. Freezing.
Good morning. Welcome to the Omni Berkshire place.
Ah, wow. I'm glad to be here. Is the heating on in the rooms?
Oh, yes.
Oh,
they
good.
Are.
And I'd like some hot and cold running women as well. And I'll sign here.
Thank
now,
you.
If I can
thank
get out before I pay the bill tomorrow, I won't be seeing you again.
Thank
right,
you.
Thank you very kindly.
You're welcome. Enjoy your stay.
Welcome to Berkshire.
Hello, Eddie. Let's
how's
get
everything?
On them stairs. There you go. Excellent.
How's it for you? What part of Europe is this from, sir?
Oh, that's Belize. That's just above Guatemala. An great old English sir. Colony. There's a brewery in Birmingham called Mitchell's and Butler's, and they have this beautifully illuminated M and a beautifully illuminated B. And they, in Birmingham, the public houses are quite large. In fact, they're very large, and they have usually have over the top what's called an assembly room, which will hold about 800 people. And you have little local dances there. And we called ourselves originally the M and B5, and we were hoping to impress M and B. enough so that they'd let us have the horse to play in and give us some money. And they sort of said no.
There was a management, a London management team, who were looking for a band to manage and promote. And it was a friend of a friend who said, you must go and see this band in Birmingham. So they came down, took one look and whisked us down to London.
It was very interesting. And it was quite remarkable. In the space of 3 weeks, I changed from a pimply, overweight, sort of 23-year-old into this gorgeous creature. I enjoyed that aspect of it.
It was a bit quick for us, to be perfectly honest, in retrospect. And we were together and number one in the charts in 6 months. In retrospect, I think it would have been better if we'd had a little bit more time together before we sort of hit any kind of success like that.
And also it's because we went the hit of the One Hit Wonders after that. We went right down and we were back to not quite where we started, but only earning like twice as much as we were after you've played the Apollo and places like that. It's quite a humbling experience. Since you gotta go, boy, you better go now.
Go down, go down. Danny Lane left the band. He was going to try his hand at going solo. And Clint, he left the band. You know, he had like personal problems. And, I mean, John Lodge was the obvious choice because I'd worked with John for years and years before that. And so I phoned John up and...
Ray's initial reaction when he spoke to me was, shall we get the old band back together? Not the Moody Blues or the continuation, but shall we get the old band back together? And... even at that time, the name Moody Blues was not necessarily going to be the name that we carried on with.
The problem then, we needed a lead guitarist singer. And that was a big slot to fill, you know, with Danny leaving the band.
And then we were fortunate enough to have Justin join and John rejoin, and that whole, which I think of as the real Moody Blues. I think of that Moody Blues, the Go Now Moody Blues, almost like the other bands I was in, like the Avengers and things like that.
And I was in a London club talking to Eric Burden, and he was reforming the Animals. And so Eric said, well, I've got a whole sack full of mail, he said, because he advertised for a guitarist. He said, I've got a whole sack full of mail. He said, and in the meantime, I found the guy I wanted. He said, so if you want to come down to the office and pick it up, you're welcome to it. And everybody who applied for this job with the Animals didn't know it was the Animals. It was just like top recording band, you know, situations vacant, you know. And it was just like one of those things. I mean, Justin's name was like the first one out of a great big sack, and I mean, we could throw the rest away then.
You seem to fit in nicely with everybody, and I mean, talk about putting in your thumb and pulling out a plum, eh? Justin Hayward from an ad in a paper.
From Mike Pinder in Moody Blues, who I knew nothing about at all. And I had a call from Mike saying that he'd heard that I was looking for a gig, and would I come up and meet the rest of the guys? And I met the guys who were living in Esher in Surrey. And as far as I'm concerned, the band have always been a southern Surrey band, you know, whatever. Because right from the beginning, we were living down south here. And I met the other guys, and I had a guitar and an amp, so I was in.
So we went to live in France. And we went across to France, Paris to live, and Belgium, a little town called Moucron. And we spent time there writing.
We had to develop a style of our own. And that was the only way that we were going to survive. And that was the... We had no money anyway, so what did we have to lose? And the way to express ourselves was through our own songs. So we really decided to write a whole stage show that would be based around our songs and based around the story of a day in the life of one guy.
So we wrote what became Days of Future Past. And we started to perform that on stage. In actual fact, the studio we're in today, here at Olympic Studios, was the very first studio we worked as, the new Moody Blues. And we actually recorded here four songs. And we took these along to the Decca Record Company, who on the basis of those four songs gave us a recording contract.
I remember when we were doing Days of Future Past and the ideas were coming for it, that I'd really decided that I wanted to write a piece about the afternoon. And it was a lovely spring day, and I was near my where I lived in Swindon in Wiltshire in the west of England. And I literally took my guitar, acoustic guitar, and went out and sat in the middle of a field on a beautiful afternoon and just started writing this song.
Just beginning to see, now I'm on my way. It doesn't matter to me, chasing the clouds away. Something calls to me. The trees are drawing me near. I've got to find out why. Those gentle voices I hear explain it all with a sigh. Myself, reflections of my mind. It's just the kind of day to leave myself behind. So gently swaying through the fairyland of love. If you just come with me, you'll see the beauty of Tuesday afternoon. Tuesday.
This used to be, and it still looks exactly the same as it did then. This is Decca One in West Hampstead, London. And this is where it all started, really, all the Moody Blues albums, that is.
DRAM, which was our label,
I'd bought out this thing called Dynamic Super Sound, which was, in actual fact, just ordinary stereo. But stereo was quite the coming thing, quite new then.
And they asked us, along with Peter Knight and the Festival Orchestra, to make a demonstration album, just for their reps to take into a shop and let them listen to this new Dynamic stereo system.
And they wanted us to do a rock version of Dvorak's New World Symphony while an orchestra played Dvorak. And we said, sure. If we can just have 5 days in the studio without anybody else coming in.
But of course, there was us sitting with our 45-minute stage show, which just happened to slot in really, really nicely.
And they flunked Days of Future Past, and they all said, well, who's going to buy that? They couldn't categorize it, you see. It's not classical, it's not pop. They had to have a pigeonhole to slot everything in.
It became one of the albums that you had to have in your collection. It didn't necessarily mean that people went out and bought it in the weeks necessary to get it in the charts.
But I remember we were driving into the studios, I think it was to make In Search of the Lost Chord. But we were driving into the studios and I was, Justin was giving me a lift, and he was a bit sad, and I said, that's just too good, something's gonna happen to it. It's just too, too good. And it's the first time I've ever been right.
Well, we're in a theatre called the Sadler's Wells Theatre, which is in East London, centre of East London. And it's really a cultural kind of mecca here. And it, for me, the Moody Blues reached a high point of sort of critical acceptance in Great Britain here in 1969, spring of 1969. And I can remember, I haven't been to this theatre since, but I can remember it very clearly, being on the stage down here. And it was a wonderful evening. Everybody's families were here. And we did a double header gig. And it was, like I say, it was the peak of our sort of acceptance by the whole sort of intellectual sort of establishment in music as well in Great Britain.
When we came back with the real Moodies, we were then sort of a real good second on the bill choice. We could be counted to put a few thousand people on the house.
We had to sort of start to build a reputation for ourselves. We weren't on, pop hit type of radio. We were starting to get played on FM radio. So our base was really through the clubs and colleges across America. That's the psychedelic, we played all the sort of psychedelic supermarkets, the electric factories. We did a lot of free concerts. We'd play anywhere. We never knew that you had to get a plane if you wanted to go from New York to San Francisco. We just drove everywhere.
That was very interesting. We were playing in small clubs and not knowing where the gig would be within 4 days' time. This was in the period when Nights was out but hadn't hit.
Sometimes we got paid, sometimes we didn't, just paid our, as we went along, we just collected gigs and paid our own way.
The thing, it sort of happened all of a sudden. I mean, Justin will always say the same thing, we used to be second on the bill, backing up Cream or various artists in Candy to be backed. And one day we turned up at a stadium and we were top of the bill. That was it.
And it was a big stadium, and Van Morrison was on the bill. Now, Van Morrison, big star, '60s. And I went to see the promoter with our roadie, and I said, what time are we on? And he said, well, you guys, you don't go on till about 11 o'clock. So we said, oh, late start? He said, no. He said, you're closing the show. I said, wow, this is Van Morrison. No, this is Moody Blues crowd. This is your crowd. And they really were. They were a Moody Blues crowd. Oh,
We're just now approaching the ports of Southampton and Portsmouth, Lymington, and this is where 250,000 people were transported by ferry in 1968 across to the Isle of Wight site. And the slogan for the festival was "Sink the Isle of Wight." That's just down here. And if you imagine the amount of people that was trying to get across for a weekend festival. And I remember when we arrived and we came across on the ferry, took the car, I couldn't believe the amount of people. And the atmosphere was absolutely electric. And you can imagine now, you know, 22 years ago, 23 years ago, the amount of people that were all over this area, and the people here hadn't seen that amount of people. I mean, there are people from all the major cities in the UK and across Europe. This brings back a lot of memories. I actually never thought I'd be coming back by helicopter though, this many years on. There's not many people here today though. Well, welcome to the Isle of Wight Festival 1990. You and me, folks, you and me. This is my precision guitar, my Fender, which recorded all of the Days of Future Past, Nights in White Satin, Tuesday Afternoon, Ride My Seesaw. And we're standing here in the field of the 69 Isle of Wight Festival, where I actually played this guitar during that set, the Bob Dylan concerts, 69. And just over there was the stage, and all the people were up on the hills here in the Isle of Wight. And it's strange to think about flower power now in the 90s, but it really did exist. And I think a lot of the people who came to these concerts and festivals all over the world have taken that spirit with them, whatever they're doing now. And it was a fantastic, fantastic time. And, you know, we're walking through all this mud. This is full of people listening to music, listening to sound systems that today were definitely archaic, but to music that something that's just continued. And we'll continue with me anyway, forever.
We were developing a much stronger sort of fan base, and along with that came another part of the whole sort of psychedelic generation, which was something we were all going through as people. Around the edge of that was a lot of craziness and a lot of spaced out people who were drawn to the Moody Blues and saw it as carrying a kind of message and being a sort of messiahs as well, and carrying the word.
A lot of people had bestowed on us gifts that we had no rights to, and we actually had no reason to say we knew the answer to the universe.
But somehow in the young American public's mind, somehow, because we asked the questions, they thought we knew the answers, and we was just as much in the dark as anybody.
I found it very amusing and very flattering that we were surrounded by that kind of adulation, and also a little bit scary, because any privacy that you thought you had just completely went out the window.
And the only people who get through the security are not nice people, because nice people get turned away. You know, they go and say, sorry, they're not seeing anybody. So, excuse me, they walk away. So it's only geezers coming down through the highlight who've been preparing their body as a temple for your blessing that get to, you know, and you start to go, wee, give this man a nice lolly.
If somebody says, Hey, you really got... Give us the word, man. You really got the answers. This part of you thinks, well, maybe I actually have. You know, and I've never really thought about it before, but maybe I actually have. All I know is that I was always, through my songs, just trying to express a truth within myself. And it's only actually, sometimes years later, that I actually find out what a song is all about and what those words actually mean.
I'm just a singer in a rock and roll band. I'm on stage playing my music. And really, the audience are singers in a rock and roll band as well, because if they actually could play the instrument, I mean, they're all air guitarists, they're all air vocalists. And if they could all be on stage, we'd all be on stage together. And it was my way of saying we're all singers in a rock and roll band.
There was a section of the audience that led to us being more and more enclosed. And as the tours went on over the years, we'd gone from travelling in a transit van to It had turned into a limo. By the sort of early 70s, it had turned into a 707 private jet, you know, with members only kind of getting on. And we never saw anybody else. You know, we were totally enclosed.
And plus the fact, I think we'd been working so close together. Everywhere I went, the other four guys went. And it was the same for them. And it got to a stage, all day, every day. And you got to the stage where you really had nothing to talk about.
We'd been touring and recording non-stop since 1967. And in 1973, we'd built up such a wall around the band. And the people we employed at the time had also built a wall around them to protect us from what I don't know.
That upset us. In fact, that's why we stopped work in 72 and didn't work again until about 77. It really is a strange feeling when you have somebody coming to you to be blessed.
And I think that was where we started to lose our own sense of identity as actual people. You know, if you start just living that life, a protected life with people running around after your every whim all the time, it's dangerous.
In fact, it really ruined Mike Pinder. It really did his head in really badly, which was one of the things we tried to sort of see if we could put right in that 4 years off, see if he could come around. But he tried, but he couldn't. He couldn't face going back out on the road again. He made Octave with us when we reformed. He couldn't go on the road. He got right as far as standing there in the office, pen in his hand, to sign the contract, and just couldn't do it.
Part of me that thought we were crazy because we'd just reached what we'd all been working for all those years. Tremendous acclaim and success all around the world. It was absolutely fantastic, mind-boggling. And then, but looking back now, I think it was the best, split for 3 years was the best thing we ever did. I think we could have gone on for another year, and we'd have split up never to come back together, which would have been sad.
We've given up trying to stop calling it a breakup, because everybody else does, so we've given up, but we used to qualify it by saying we didn't actually break up, we just stopped working.
And fortunately, we came out of the other side of it a stronger and a happier band. Everybody was much more honest, you know? Mike was more honest about his own feelings, that he didn't want to go on the road, or he didn't really want to be part of it anymore. And to this day, I miss Mike very much. I miss his songs particularly, because he was the first Moody Blue I met. I met him sometime before I met the other guys. And Patrick, his replacement, has brought an energy and a power to the band, which was exactly what we needed.
You know, we got together at the very beginning to make music. And it's always been the music, providing you can, it's like Zen, it's like beaming in onto one thing. And the music is the Moody Blues.
You know, you get three of us round a microphone, and we all, the three of us start to sing together, and it sounds like the Moody Blues, it doesn't sound like anybody else. And that's hard to, that's a little bit of fairy dust, you know. And you don't throw that away and forget about it.
Long time, no see. Short time for you and me. So fine, so good. We're on the road like you knew we would. First night, so long. State of mind, what can go wrong? We're here, the time is right to rock and roll. Right through the night.
Gemini Dream was written to really celebrate the Moody Blues getting back on stage. I wanted to try and put on record what it was like to be one day on stage, this rock and roll persona, this person, and the next day to be at home like everyone else.
Well, this is my music room that we're in right now, and this is the place where most of my songs have been written over the years, since about 1969, 1970. It's kind of an inner sanctum and a very special place. All of the songs for the last two albums were written in here, and many of them are actually recorded on this little machine and then taken into the studio. It's also a place for a number of trophies and gold discs and ASCAP awards, which is the Association of Composers and Authors, American Songwriters, which I've had a number of ASCAP awards, and they really mean a lot to me. Songwriting for me is one of those things that is just such a magic moment. The time when you write a song, when it comes to you, I tend not to analyze it too much because I just don't know where it comes from. But it is the most beautiful feeling, and it's something from nothing. You know, something that didn't exist a few minutes before, and it's a wonderful thing.
Won't you take me back to school? I need to learn the golden rule. Won't you lay it on the line? I need to hear it just one more time. Oh, won't you tell me again? Tell me again tonight. Each and every heart, it seems, is bounded by a world of dreams. Each and every rising sun is greeted by a lonely one. Oh, won't you tell me again? Oh, can you feel it? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight? Of life, my love, there's so many storms we must rise above. Can you hear the spirit calling as it's carried across the waves? You're already falling, it's calling you back to face the music and the song, and it's coming through. You're already falling. Make a promise, take a vow, and trust your feelings, it's easy now. Understand the voice within, and feel a change already beginning. Oh, won't you tell me again? Oh, can you feel it? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight? And you're back up against the past. You're already falling, it's calling you on to face the music and the song, and it's coming through. You're already falling, the one that is calling is you. Each and every heart, it seems, is bounded by every rising sun is greeted by a lonely, lonely one. Won't you tell me again? Oh, can you feel it? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight? Oh, won't you tell me again? Oh, can you feel it? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight? Can you feel it tonight? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight?
Making a video is good fun, but it's taught me to have an enormous respect for actors now, because the biggest shoot I've been on was for The Other Side of Life, and that was like 4 days, and I was going crazy with boredom.
The Other Side of Life is my favorite, and it's the video is pretty weird. And there was a very young scriptwriter, he was something like 17 years old, who really put those ideas into the video. And but the song itself came from, we went back when we started working with Tony Visconti to working in the middle of Soho, right in the middle of London, which I thought was great. It was the area, the real music area of London, where every musician comes when he's just starting out, you know, and all the great studios are there, and it's a great working area. A lot of people would come by, and Soho was inspirational to The Other Side of Life, and looking at the other side of your own personality and character as well, the sort of deeper, more sensual, sort of darker side.
Atmosphere on the streets tonight is the driving beat of the world. The word down here on the streets tonight is the truest music you've heard. So take your share of the gifts that are there. They all belong.
Baby, baby, baby,
question was a song that's very dear to me, really, and it was amazing how it all came together, because I was sitting in my little one-bedroom flat in Barnes, and it's like 1969, 1970, and I had two songs, both in the key of C, one lovely slow song, and one really energetic, sort of very fast protest sort of song, really with the thoughts around the Vietnam War and trying to reflect a lot of people in the United States where we're suddenly becoming very popular. I was trying to reflect what they were saying to me and their own people in that audience, people who were expected to be drafted, you know, any moment and all that kind of stuff. And anyway, the night before the session, I still hadn't really got a complete song. So it was like some dink light bulb, you know, above the head. Oh, hey, I'll put these two songs in the same key. What if I just actually put them together?
Knocking at the door with a thousand million questions about hate and death and war. 'Cause when we stop and look around us, there is nothing that we need in a world of persecution that is burning in its greed.
You know, I think with rock and roll, it's... I mean, we're the first people to have lived through it. I think people expected it to be like a flash in the pan. Come and go.
You know, people come along and say, don't you think you should do this, or what about this, or how's the new music affecting you, or whatever. But we've just, you know, you try to say, this is what I believe, this is what the song I want to write today. This is the way I want to present that song. And I think we've been really fortunate enough that a lot of the people who buy Moody Blues music or like Moody Blues music have said, OK, that's where the band is, and we're going to accept that.
It's the people's music, isn't it? And it's stuck, and it's evolved. It isn't just 1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, or whatever, and who put the bop into the bop-de-bop, or whatever. I mean, it's grown and matured.
Our basic ground rule from day one, really, when we got rid of the blue suits and the cravats and the hairstyles and the same image, was that we had to be truthful to ourselves, and we had to just rely on ourselves for our own music. And the Moody Blues music has come from exactly that.
Just look into my eyes.
People have discovered the Moody Blues for themselves. And I know what that's like because, of course, I'm a fan of music as well. I'm a fan of so many people. And I know what their music means to me. And when you discover a band for yourself without any kind of hype or anything like that, it's a great thing to... it becomes part of your life, and the Moody Blues is part of a lot of people's lives.
One of the joys of touring is that you do... you obviously don't recognise everyone, but people do actually send you notes backstage or letters or actually find the way backstage sometimes. And they say, we saw you first in 1960, whenever, and we're here now, and here's our children.
And we met this one couple, well, two couples, parents and children, and they'd come home with a long-distance Voyager. And they come home, the kids had and played it, and the mum says, oh, that's quite nice, who's that? And they go, oh, Moody Blues. And the mother goes, hang on a minute, and goes up in the loft and comes down with Days of Future Past and so on. And apparently that was the first bridge that they had.
People have travelled with us along our journey, and we're very proud of that.
Well, I think the last two albums really brought us another wave of fans. And I hadn't been screamed at since the Moody Mania days in 65, 66. And the last couple of tours, you walk on stage and you think somebody's come on behind you, you turn around, makes you...
I've been thinking about our fortune, and I've decided that we're really not to blame for the love that's deep inside us now. It's still the same. And the sound we make together is the music to the story in your eyes. It's been shining down upon me now, I realize. Listen to the tide slowly turning, wash all our heartaches away. Turns away. Listen to the tide slowly turning, wash all our heartaches away. Sometime we've been waiting for, we turn to rain. When the final line is over and it's sudden that the curtain's gonna fall, I can hide inside you, sweet, sweet love, forevermore.
People think you play the same every night. Well, of course you don't. There's a myriad, tiny little differences every night. And on the night where they all come off, you walk off for that hour off stage, that afterglow for an hour is the best feeling, you know. And we shut the door because it would sound too egotistic if there was other people around. We shut the door and get really gleeful about how great we played and compliment each other on how good you was and how good you was and all that, and really have a real good together thing. Then open the door and people come in and, oh, you really think so? Well, thank you, that's very kind. You know, all that stuff.
Well, Graham is... he's a typical drummer. I mean, I think they get like tap happy. I think it's, you know, it's beating your instrument rather than caressing it. You know, I think it does something to drummers' brains. I've never come across a drummer who isn't like Ryan. Not a good drummer. They're all like that.
Well, Ray and I, of course, we've known each other so many years now. It was before the book was starting to be written, and we've grown up together. We learned to drive cars together. We went to clubs together before clubs really began. And we've grown up, not just the music between ourselves. We've grown up as people. and we've seen our personal lives grow. We've seen our hopes, our disappointments grow as people, not just as artists.
Well, I feel that John is a very private man. He's got a fantastic drive and an energy which I think is you know very enviable, and I admire that very much. And I think we obviously the two of us have a lot in common. We came to the band at the same time, and we really. I think we've done so many things sort of together. We made an album together that there's a sort of kindred spirit between us. And there's a lot of things that I can't actually say about John because there's a lot of unsaid feeling between us, you know?
Well, Justin is a very sensitive guy. And I love him. I think he brought to this band really what the band needed to, you know, to give it so much more scope, you know, as opposed to just, you know, the straightforward rock and roll. It was, I think he gave it a lot of light and shade.
Every time I put the headphones on for a new recording session, we're working together, put the headphones on a routine, it's like, it's that sound again, you know, it's only these people can make that kind of sound.
I think we're like brothers. And the nice thing about having brothers that you're not related to, you actually went out and picked them. They weren't sort of thrust upon you. And I think we're closer than just friends. It's more like family. We've always said that.
I'm buried right there somewhere. I know I'll find you somehow, and somehow I'll return again. Is lifting slowly. I can see the way, and I've left behind the empty streets that once inspired my life. And the strength of the emotion is like thunder in the air. 'Cause the promise that we made each other haunts me to the end. Somewhere, I know you're out there somewhere, somewhere you can hear my voice. I know I'll find you somehow, somehow, somehow. I know I'll find you somehow, and somehow I'll return again. Of your beauty and the mystery of your soul, I've been searching for in everyone I meet. And the times I've been mistaken, it's impossible to say. And the grass is growing underneath our feet. I know you're out there somewhere. Somewhere you can hear my voice. I know I'll find you somehow, somehow, somehow. I know I'll find you somehow, and somehow I'll return again to you. I know it's gonna happen.
No, it's gonna
I can feel you getting near. And see you'll be returning to the fountain of our youth. And if you wake up wondering, in the darkness I'll be there.
You know I'll be
My arms will close around you and protect you with the truth. I know you're out there somewhere, somewhere, somewhere. I know you're out there somewhere, somewhere. You can hear my voice. I know I'll find you somehow, somehow. Somehow I'll return again to you.
I'd go around again. Oh, I tell you, we were young and free. Oh, I tell you, 'cause I was there, you see. Sounds so good to me.